With that, we begin our fourth day of the workshop. And today our guest is Madam Reena Saini Kalat. She's an artist. She practices spanning, her practice spans drawing, photography, sculpture, and video, engaging diverse materials imbued with conceptual underpinnings. Through her use of material, form, and content, her work has always had a prescient relevance to our lives today more than ever. She speaks of the times we live in through looking at notions of memory, identity, and the ideas of borders and the nation state. She has widely exhibited at institutions across the world, such as Museum of Modern Art, New York, Tate Modern, London, Mori Art Museum, Tokyo, Kennedy Center, Washington, amongst many others. And most recently, she is showing works at our own CSMVS, which is our Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, Shahu Maharaj Vastu Sangrahalaya in Mumbai. It's very tongue-twisting. Boston's Institute of Contemporary Arts and the Curitiba Biennial in Brazil. So we welcome you, ma'am, for today. And we'd request our group director, Dr. Salunke, to felicitate her. And Piyush also could join in, please. Thank you. And another piece of instruction would be, please make a note of your questions. We'll take the questions at the end of her session.
Thank you. This is such an extraordinary morning with a lot of young friends in the audience. I think this is such a great initiative, and to look at how various disciplines approach similar problems. But of course, art plays an important role in looking at and reflecting on problems of our time and critiquing them and highlighting them. And I think what I'm really looking forward to is seeing the kind of design solutions that all of you are working towards. So I'm hoping to engage more deeply with what results from this coming together of all of you wonderful minds. I mean, I just thought I'll put together a cross-section of my work. Of course, we'd like to take more questions. And so I shall just take you through some of the more recent work, which in terms of thematics, I'll have to apologize for my voice, which is suffering over the last few days. So I'm sorry about that. But what we could do is, with the recent work, a lot of the ideas recur throughout with taking different forms in different works. And the most recent of my exhibitions being Blind Spots, which just closed a few weeks ago at Kemal Prescott Road, which is a gallery that I've worked with for the last two decades. This is a piece that actually the exhibition title derives from this piece called Blind Spots, that essentially is a seven-channel, which will eventually be an eight-channel video, that as you access these eye charts, it's a kind of fragmented recital of the constitutions of countries such as India, Pakistan, there's Serbia, Croatia, North and South Korea, there's US, Cuba, and so basically what you look at as you encounter the piece are these sort of individual alphabets that appear at a time. I mean, it's, like I said, it's a kind of fragmented recital of the constitutions of countries that are either in conflict or, I keep going back to the constitution as the sort of promise of democracy that, of course, it was at a time when some of these values were being eroded. I mean, I began working with the Indian constitution in 2003, post-2002, when pretty much a lot of the same debates that we see globally today were, am I audible? Yeah. Were very much part of our, understanding of what was happening within the city of Mumbai, where North Indian migrants were being there was great resistance towards accepting these North Indian migrants. And it was at such a time where I felt that, you know, we needed to relook at what the Constitution, this promise of democracy offers in terms of equality, justice, some of the sort of foundational values, and revisiting them through this piece, where in the act of viewing, you're confronted by certain words morphing into Braille as a sort of metaphor of having lost sight of our commonalities through difference. And the work really plays on this kind of the idea of our own perceptual limitations, where we have such polarized views that we're almost failing to be able to understand the other side or another perspective. And what you hear through these this apparatus are sounds of people reading the Constitution from both sides. And I mean, it's really about our own ways of thinking. So the piece derives its title from the physiological blind spot, which is when the eye, the optic nerve in the eye, there's missing data, and the brain really interpolates information through other sources, and to complete the gaps in our understanding, as we know. So that's scientifically how we process information. And I'm really interested in that space of interpretation as what we see and how we sort of process that information, and what transpires within that space of memory, of recall, and memory itself being a complex set of interactions between seeing, remembering, imagining, some shaped by language, some by imagery. And like I said, these works then take on different forms. So while in the experience of accessing those preambles to constitutions in the work called Blind Spots, in this case it's called Verso Recto, Recto Verso, where you have scrolls that are actually made with the process of tie and dye, where the Braille are, again, these are the same values, foundational values such as liberty, equality, justice, freedom, so on, that are common to both sides. But the fact that Braille is made with the process of tie and dye, and I work with craftspeople in the northwestern region of Gujarat in Kutch, where again, it's a kind of surviving art that only continues in both, say, Kutch and Karachi. And again, you're looking at border-sharing states. And I mean, I'm always referring to these long-shared histories, which are civilizational histories, and yet we seem to be constantly battling over our differences. And so the works really allude to those bonds beyond the borders, and much of the work reflects on these borders, not just physical borders, because I've been interested much more in the psychological, social barriers between people more than the physical borders themselves. And the same words then appear in these small placards, where the rest of the preamble is almost invisible. And the space of legibility and illegibility, and what really meets the eye and what underlies it. And this is a work called Leaking Lines. And just to give you a little bit of my own background, I mean, I was born and brought up here in very much in Bombay, born in Delhi, but brought up in Bombay. But my father was born in Lahore, and he'd moved to Punjab in India pre-partition, but his brothers moved post-partition. And so very early years of my growing up, I was always fascinated by stories about how people left everything and moved. And at that point, of course, I didn't realize it would have such a strong bearing on my practice, where I constantly saw myself going back to that moment of this line. And a line is such an integral part of an artist's toolkit, but when you think of a line drawn across territory, has such huge implications for people on either side. that decides the fate of citizens and the implications to their lives. So besides the Radcliffe line, which is very much part of our consciousness, I mean, the more I thought about the Durand line across Afghanistan, Pakistan, or McMahon line between Tibet and Arunachal Pradesh, between India, China, or the blue line, the green line, I mean, between Lebanon and Israel, or the blue line, or the Maginot line, Mannerheim line, and you see this sort of colonial project of divisiveness and how this line just cuts across communities, religious communities, ethnic communities. You think of the Pashtun population that the Durand line runs across. And of course, there are no borders in nature. I mean, you think of continuities through mountains and rivers and they are, of course, a political construct. And some of these are what the work actually refers to, whether they are territorial delineations made through electric cables. So one of the other mediums that I have extensively worked with is the electric cable that is meant to transmit energy exchange as communication cable that actually, you know, in this moment of human history where we are so much more connected than ever before through trade, technology, commerce, we've really managed to blur these lines, these geographic lines, and yet today these nationalistic sort of borders are so much more in amidst us. And these sort of rise in nationalisms across the world. And so these are all made using the electric cable, which has now become a kind of, so they form these barbed wires and fences holding inherent contradictions of being both a conduit carrier and a barrier at the same time. So this is the Mason-Dixon line across the southern states in the US and the northern states, the slave states and Mannerheim line. And of course, some of these were fortifications during the wars. These are some sound-based works. They're called chorus. And it's a body of work that I've developed over the years. Where a lot of my work refers to, so these ideas of conflict on the one hand, but confluence of coming together from both sides has also been something that has recurred through the practice, whether it's looking at species that are an imaginary species of natural forms. So when you think of not just political divides, I mean, you know, we've actually, the human race has been so divisive in terms of claiming ownership to natural forms that when you think of how we fight over, say, the hoopoe bird being the Israeli national bird, and in my research, I was reading up about how Israelis were trying to change the name of the Palestinian sunbird simply because it exists on their postage stamps. And I was thinking about how we are claiming ownership to these natural forms that don't belong to either. They're, you know, we've made them national symbols and they were always meant to unite people from a region. And here they've again become points of conflict where we are claiming ownership to these forms. And that became a whole body of work where I began combining these one half from each side of border sharing territories. And so much so that there was a whole range of birds, whether it's the hoopoe bird, you know, from Israel singing to the Palestinian sunbird. So what you see in these sculptures are, they're modeled on pre-radar acoustic devices that were built during the wars to track sounds of enemy aircrafts. And so these were, in those years, mechanisms, like I said, this was pre-radar technology, and so they were actually, you stepped into these sculptures, and which I now call sculptures, but they were meant to be used as apparatuses that would allow you to track the sounds of airplanes before they come. And I wanted to sort of subvert those notions of war by having bird songs and birds in communication across borders, where they, of course, know no boundaries. And so you essentially step into these cultures, and so they're, in a sense, interactive. And but some of these will be shown at the Hayward Gallery in London, and one of which was shown in Wolfsburg in Germany. And so these travel to different places. More recently shown, one of them was shown at the Sculpture Park in Jaipur. And so this one's in metal, the other two are in FRP. Then there's a whole body of works where, I mean, I always think of, you know, when you think of the nucleus of the problem between countries that are in conflict, I mean, the heart of it would also be natural resource, whether it's land, whether it's water, and, you know, water wars being waged over rivers, where they also become a powerful force to settle transboundary conflicts, because there is that dependency on water that is shared. And often you think of rivers as, you know, when you have these water sharing treaties between countries, it often results in the partitioning of the rivers. And a lot of works that I've done, again, referring to the River Indus and its multiple tributaries, where Ravi, Bid, Satluj flow into India, Jhelum, Chenab, and the River Indus into Pakistan. And I would always think of how, of course, we know how we are manipulating the course of rivers, and through dam projects and hydroelectric projects and so on. And this is a work called Shifting Ecotones, where I'm also always overlaying ideas of, you know, of course, ecotones is a term derived from ecology, where it's that transition phase between two biomes, and it's meant to be the most biodiverse zone, because, you know, there is an overlap of two biomes. And I was sort of referring to these ecotones as an overlaying ideas of cultural diversity, because, you know, we all know we grew up in a city like Mumbai, which is the most cosmopolitan city, and that was something we have immense pride in, the fact that you have every possible religion of the world living together, and, you know, despite all its difficulties, we know that it still remains a very successful democracy, which is why we, you know, fight for making sure there is no erosion of those values. And I think what we are seeing today all over the nation with students is what I find incredible, when they come out to speak and voice their dissent. And that's something that every artist values very much, the freedom of expression and dissent. And to come back to this work, the River Danube, the River Nile, I mean, when I think of several rivers across the world, and you think of them as, and these are seen as how, I mean, this kind of invisible hand that is reshaping and remodeling this natural environment and our control over natural resources. But just to run through a lot of works that, you know, address similar ideas, but in, like I said, in various forms in different works. This is a set of works that I have been making since 2011, called Woven Chronicle, that actually traces the movement of migrants historically, beginning with indenture labor and migrations, you know, pre-industrial, agricultural, industrial, post-industrial societies. And again, when you think of the flows and movements of migrants, and you think of the hyper-connected world. So it's a piece again that's woven using the electric cable that, like I mentioned previously, I mean, I always think of this as communication cable that connects us. And here it's treated almost like yarn, where this web work of movement of people, and I see this map as a dynamic entity through the course of travelers. And it has a sound component that actually has these throbbing, pulsating sounds of high voltage electric current, deep sea drone sounds, communication tones, and migratory birds, and so on, based on industrial maps. So the zoning is based on industrial maps, and color codes come from there. But this has also been a work that has been shown extensively. This was at the Museum of Modern Art in New York, but is now being shown in Boston at ICA Boston, and goes to sites Santa Fe, New Mexico. These are some of the works, which is from the body of work called Hyphenated Lives, where what I was previously mentioning about this kind of imaginary species of birds, animals, flowers, trees that are formed with one half coming from each side of countries that are either partitioned or in conflict. So they form new terms, coined names, such as the Dion is a cross between the deer and the lion from, you know, UK and Ireland. And they're both national symbols of national animals from Ireland and UK. And this was always conceived to be like in a natural history museum setting, where they're modeled on zoological, botanical drawings, that I almost thought of a species that perhaps existed in the past, or a kind of proposition for the future where they may converge. And so it was like turning to a species other than the human race at this moment of human history, where, you know, I feel like, for us to look at how we might cohabit this planet, we need to turn to signals from nature, and where you know that the disappearance of one results in the disappearance of another. And so these ideas of our interdependence and our coexistence are pretty much recurrent. So this was in Wolfsburg in Germany, where these are shown as a room, like in a natural history museum setting. And so PL is a cross between the peacock and the doyle from Bangladesh and India. And previously, all the references to rivers, like Tista, again, between, and the conflict over the rivers between Bangladesh and India. And the sanpu is again a cross, like I was saying, between the hoopoe bird and the Palestinian sunbird. But here they kind of seamlessly come together with the crown of the hoopoe and the body of the... And in some cases, I kind of maintain the violence of that line, where the sayok is the cypress and the oak tree. Cleft is a kind of conglomeration of all of these coming together as individual drawings that form a kind of globe where all of these, you know, fly free and come together to converge. Or in case of these landscapes, which are called Garden of Forking Paths, which I've made one every year. And it takes its title from Borges, the Argentine poet's essay, which is paradise. I mean, you know about the Garden of Forking Paths refers to not just forking in space, but also in time, where I almost see these as a present that is formed with these divergent routes that one could take from the past and the future. I'll just quickly take you through this so that we have enough time for questions. These are, again, Siamese trees is how it all grew with the electric cable, where one half grows into the banyan tree and the other into the Devdhatri, again coming from shared roots, and essentially that's the way the metaphor emerged of these long shared histories of a past, that is. And you think of how histories have shaped geographies over time, and how and then there's this idea of the human anatomy that also recurs. So you have this you know, the lungs, and it's called half oxygen, but also the overlay of the piece that you saw, the apparatus in blind spots, where the left brain and the right brain are kind of interacting with each other with the device. And many of them have a sensor. So in this case, you have the sounds of the heartbeat and the river, and in other cases where it's the roots light up. How are we doing in terms of time? Do we have another 5 minutes? This is the line of control between India and Pakistan. And as you step up close, the buzzer starts to beep as you come close to the work. These are called ruled paper, red, blue, white, where, I mean, I'm sure most of you are aware of our sort of early introduction to learning how to write was in these red and blue lines, where you learn to toe the line in a sense. And I was also referring to our own indoctrination into ways of thinking, and to think of red, blue, white as colors of the colonial flag, and what you really bring to an empty sheet of paper when you carry your own preconceived notions, your you know, prejudices, and all of these ideas that you bring, and these kinds of distortions. I think we'll just run through some more of these works, which are again, which are quite evidently one gate from each side of the border, at the Wagah-Atari border. This is a work from over a decade ago, which is called Light Leaks, Winds Meet Where the Waters Spill Deceit, and again alludes to our long shared histories, but has a fly zapper that, again, with an electric grid and a UV tube, where so much of the movement of people across these entry points is controlled and regulated, unlike before. And you have the crease crevice contour, again, is a work that actually traces the changing line of control between India and Pakistan before the ceasefire line got frozen as the line of control. And so you have 10 stages of the war between 47 and 48. But stamped on the back of a body, almost like a wound on the back. But I was always impacted by, like I said, the line of control, and to think of this kind of incision on the land. Mm. And a whole body of work that I made nearly a decade and a half using the rubber stamp. So I'm going backwards to the oldest works I did, where the stamp as a bureaucratic apparatus both confirms, legitimizes, provides state sanction, or denies citizenship in a sense. And so I made portraits of migrants, you know, in early, like 2007, 8, that formed portraits of migrants made with those who've gone missing, or in this case, they are names of people who've been denied visas. And we know the denial of visa is based so much on perceptions of class, gender, nationality, religion, and the rubber stamp as an obstacle, as something that really denies entry. So these were playful works, but also, in a sense, taking on ideas of citizenship. And I come back to where we began with the preamble of the Constitution. So in some of the earliest works, like I said, when I began working with the stamp, it was in a work that actually was meant to be an inclusionary exercise to try and stamped names of people from various regions in India claiming ownership within the mock document of the preamble. And so that is what accompanied the sculpture. But these are all made with the stamps, and they're in over 14 language scripts. But the sense of anonymity of an individual in this vast ocean of humanity, where an individual is often reduced to an anonymous statistic. And these are called synonyms. So I will end with this idea of an individual in this ocean of large numbers of people. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I request the volunteers to please get the chairs on the dais. That was quite an impressive presentation. I mean, I think all of you would appreciate the creative expression, what's in the mind of an artist, and what we think in qualitative terms. You know, it's a perception, and everyone has a way to express himself. But what was communicated through this was superb. And I think for all those people who are in Mumbai, at least the next time we have an exhibition from her at Shivaji Maharaj Vastu Sangha, we'll definitely go there, all of us, to see that. And yeah, so I hope you have got your questions ready while she settles down. We'd like to take the questions from the back. I'd request those who have asked some questions, maybe we give an opportunity to the others also to come in and ask the questions, okay? Yeah? So we'll take your question, don't worry.
Morning, ma'am. So I loved your memories of partition part in Mumbai, in London. So my question is, art has always been social and political in its expressions. But especially when we look in the field of academia, many of the voices of students and professors, they have been disregarded completely by the authorities and especially by the government of India. So what do you think that when students protest, they've been asked to go back to books, go back to your studies, and why is they apparently wasting the taxpayers' money? So why is their voice not as not has been given enough respect? And is the non-cooperation movement by students, is that the correct way of showing dissent?
Well, of course, nobody would promote violence, and I think the fact that these are genuine concerns, and I mean, and it is the future that. Am I audible? Sorry, am I? Yeah. I was saying that you are the voices of the future, and while I'm not here to promote anything, I'm just saying that we have to be able to dialogue about these things, and that it's, you know, all of these voices of dissent, I'm not necessarily going to say that, you know, the means adopted are, as long as they are completely peaceful, and I mean, we need to build more communication, because I see that, I mean, each of us are getting more and more polarized, and that is not, it's not the way ahead. We all know that we have to be much more tolerant to other views, however difficult they may be. And I think that applies to both sides. I mean, I think we all carry our own limited understanding, which is why I always think of how, while, you know, we have come with our own conditioning and what we see, what we hear, and there's always another way of approaching the same thing. But so long as we can keep those communication lines open.
Ma'am, firstly, I admire your work, you know, expressing art in an innovative form, okay? Now, I'm just getting a random thought, okay? Can you just answer that? Now, the thing is, if you are asked to showcase your artistic form to the blind people, how do you do that?
Accessed by either. That's the whole thing of this idea of illegibility, both to those who are sighted and who are blind. So it's kind of making the work inaccessible is very much the space in which I'm trying to work. That the space of having lost access to being able to see some of these core values, like I said. So it is quite intended that the work is not going to be seen by either. So even in other works where I actually started working with Braille through my own personal experience of having of loss, I mean, of having lost my mother when I was really young as a little girl. And I grew up with all the things she left behind, amongst which were her, you know, her saris, her personal belongings. And I'd sort of built a relationship with the things she left behind. And at some point, having come full circle with my own experience with motherhood, I would go back to my early childhood years. And I decided to translate her handwritten recipe books into Braille to make these scrolls that were made with the process of tie and dye. And in fact, that was the intended thing, that neither the blind nor those sighted will be able to access those works, I mean, the text. So the illegibility aspect was key to the work, because I was also thinking and referring to these ideas of the limitations or the inadequacies of language in being able to communicate loss of a certain kind that's emotional and that cannot be fully expressed through language. So it's a very good question that was very much intended in the making of the work itself.
Yeah. We have time for a question. Yeah. We have a faculty.
Accessibility and legibility. The world seems to be divided into two forms of major expression. Majorly through text, then other forms. It's kind of, you know, that dividing line, that barbed wire line, right, that you showed. So how do we start a conversation from both ends? I'm talking from an academician.
Right. You know, I'm not, I mean, I can't claim to really be the one offering solutions, but I mean, I know that one way to look at it is to be self-critical. I think that's the one thing that I feel we all need to really, that's what I think art allows you to do, is to reflect back on the world we live in and the spaces we inhabit. And which is why perhaps I feel that I don't think the human race is really a great example at this point. Anywhere in the world you look at, I mean, I feel that we are facing a lot of, you know, issues globally, and these are not isolated only to, particularly to our country alone. And there is this rise of, you know, right-wing nationalism and those values. But at the same time, I think to keep communication lines is the only way, and not becoming so intolerant, whether we are of this view or that. And I find often, even in conversations within families, within homes, within neighborhoods, we are becoming very intolerant of each other's views. And that is fundamentally going to be a problem unless we're going to be able to listen to each other. So maybe the space to begin with is really the space to begin to listen. But like I said, I mean, and also what I feel is that we have to rise above those in power who are controlling, who are clearly playing their politics. And as people, we need to remember that we have to rise above those and make sure that we are not being manipulated, because frankly, that's what is happening to all of us, because each one of us, no matter where we live in the world, are aspiring for a better life, for a peaceful world. And yet, we know that this division is being injected, this kind of hate-based poisoning of our minds are purely being done to serve another agenda of power. And as long as we can be aware of that and realize that the enemy is elsewhere, is not between us. And I think I find that the only way forward within homes, within families, because as you would know, I mean, even to have a conversation with some of your close friends, you have such polarizing views on matters. And I find that I don't want to burn any more bridges, but to know that the enemy is not amidst us, but outside. And
Thank you so much.
I think
we'll take it off the room. I'm so sorry. I'm just maintaining the timelines. And I think the message that I can take away from you is we need to rise above. And in our projects on social innovation, on our mission and our workshops, we all need to rise above and bring out some great solutions at the end of the day. I'd request Piyush to come in and make some announcements. And Reena, thank you so much for that beautiful presentation.